Hi, this is Mark Patterson, University Ombud for Cal State University Channel Islands, with another episode of Channel Our Potential, where we ask the question, what does it mean to you to channel our potential at CSU Channel Islands? My guest for this episode is Dr. LaSonya Davis, who has been teaching at Cal State Channel Islands since 2012 in the nursing department, where she's for the last 5 years been serving as the assistant chair. Dr. Davis, however, is not new to nursing. She has 25 years of experience as a registered nurse and over 18 years as a family nurse practitioner. Dr. Davis received a bachelor's degree from Fresno State University and went on to get a doctorate in nursing practice from Western University of Health Sciences and a postgraduate certification as a women's health nurse practitioner from Duke University, my alma mater for law school. She is also serving as the president's faculty fellow, a new role created by President Beck. She also serves as a member from the beginning of the President's Advisory Council on Inclusive Excellence. With that, we'll go now to Dr. Davis. Hi, LaSonya. It's so good to finally get a chance to talk to you. And I've been impressed how you've been involved in so many ways across campus and helping connect people in sometimes some pretty powerful and challenging ways. And so I kind of wanted to start off with just your general thoughts on the importance of helping people find connection across campus, particularly in some of the times of challenge around racial justice.
So when I first started at CI in 2012, it was my first time in full-time academia, and it was really important for me to put my feet on solid ground. I had been a clinician for many years in the field of nursing, but I had only taught per diem, one course at a city college. At the same time, I wanted to learn the ropes and have a mentor. The problem was in our department, we didn't have anyone there that was able to mentor me. So I ended up reaching out to other faculty of color. And that's how I learned how to navigate the waters of CI. And I, because I'm a go-getter, I went after people. the other thing too is that at the time we were doing centralized hiring. So a lot of the new hires, I got to know during the hiring process, the 3 days of us being on campus and being interviewed together, going through the same stress together. And once they made the announcements on the people that were actually coming in as new tenure track faculty, I knew some of the people already. So I had already started developing friendships. So I had my little pod. People that you would normally come in contact with, they're interdisciplinary as one of our pillars. You would normally come in contact through the hiring process, even as a tenured faculty member attending someone else's hiring process. So those kinds of things were very helpful when thinking about that. So that kind of leads us to thinking more about equity and equity in as a Black faculty, one of the few. Right now, we only have 4 Black faculty on campus, and thinking about how to navigate the waters and how to feel supported. That was part of the reason why I started doing equity work and anti-bias training in my department. And that has now further extended across campus and with our past president, President Beck, implementing the Inclusive Excellence Strategic Plan, then that gave me an actual opportunity to work more directly on a higher level.
So your interests began really kind of organically when you were seeking role models and mentors, particularly within the Black community. And then it sounds like you wanted to give back as you advance professionally and have begun to see that more broadly across campus. Where do you see opportunities in that regard going? Are there things that are kind of, particularly in this role as President's Faculty Fellow, where you're able to maybe even expand that vision?
Right now, we're creating an inclusive excellent action plan across our campus. We realize that changing the milieu, the culture of our campus is necessary to impact systematic change, systematic racism that we know, these structures that exist, whether they're intentional structures or unconscious structures and bias and those types of things. How do we get to the root of that and change the culture on our campus to be one that is inclusive, that's welcoming, that's equitable in all types of ways to all of its constituents, faculty, staff, students, and the community surrounding us. Being able to be a part of this, a major part of this work, and working with the President's Advisory Council on Inclusive Excellence over the last 3 years to see this come to fruition is really exciting, and I'm excited to be a part of it.
It really is unusual, I think, in higher education, the model that you're helping champion, this distributed model of inclusive excellence or equity building. There is, you know, far beyond hiring somebody and having them lead a DEI office. It seems that you're really working within a larger context of trying to get that more deeply embedded in the culture. You know, there was an article you shared with me a while ago, thinking about connection, almost seemed counterintuitive. And it was essentially noting the dangers of what we've come to call allyship within higher education. Now, on the face of it, that sounds kind of, again, counterintuitive. How do you kind of see those two things reconciled?
I think that one of the biggest mistakes that people make is the action part. So it's like when you recognize something that you feel is inequitable or unjust, you want to act on it and you want to act right away. And sometimes that is a mistake in it within itself, because the action part comes later. There's some other assessment and investigation that needs to take place before that. The article that I shared with you talked about how allyship in the classroom. So trying to build an anti-racist classroom, which ends up being racist itself, because not intentionally, because the person is actually trying to put measures in place of allyship and dismantling systemic racism, ends up perpetuating things, because in fact, they have not usually, whoever's making the rules are usually not the ones that are impacted by the injustices that have occurred. So it's really important that the people that are being impacted by the injustices that are happening are at the table. What an ally might think is the best approach may in fact perpetuate racism or these same behaviors to the offending group. Nursing is a prime example of that. We'll go into a community, say here in Ventura County, we have a lot of farm worker families that have health disparities, food insecurities, lack of health insurance, a lot of other social determinant of health gaps. And we'll say, okay, we know what's best for you. And we're like, we know what's best for you. So this is what you need to do. You need to eat healthy. You need to exercise. You need to do this, this, that, and the other. But have we invited them to the table to ask them what do they need? What are their problems? Where are their barriers? How can we help versus we know what's best for you because we're here and you're here. So you're still perpetuating that racist unconscious bias that we have, that I know what's best.
Like that, yeah, that having people come to the table, even if a well-meaning, particularly as a white man, for example, I would come in and mean well, but if I'm coming in with approach, I'm your ally and I know what's best, I'm not bringing people truly to the table in the way you're talking about. Are there other experiences, like you mentioned, in the community where you're seeing that connection and as a nursing professional?
I'm still in practice, so I still have patients that I take care of in the community. My primary specialty is women's health. So I was able to implement centering healthcare with farm worker women who are mostly my patients are farm worker families. And bringing them together, building community amongst them to help reduce maternal morbidity and mortality or early delivery, and also depression, postpartum and intrapartum, and prenatal depression. To me, I'm an ally to farm worker families. I mean, I come from second generation of farm workers. My grandparents were farm workers on both sides. One side of my family, they owned the land and they sharecropped it out to other people. The other side of my family, they owned their own land, but they actually worked the land. So in a way, I understand the concepts, but at the same time, I'm not from the community and I don't even really fluently speak the language. But one thing that I did learn is that caring, and the art of caring is what nursing is all about, is cross cultures, is cross languages. People understand when you care and when you're actually trying to do something to help.
Yeah, I ask about that because I sense a real power in the model of being in a caring profession, but also seeking to influence and change policy, like the work with Inclusive Excellence Action Plan and the teams that are being developed along with that. So yeah, I like that opportunity there. LaSonya, I always finish with one question. And so I will pose the question to you. What does it mean to you, Dr. Davis, to channel our potential as employees at CSU Channel Islands?
To channel our potential, I think that we should look forward to what we can be and not where we are right now. It's important for us to assess where we are right now, but I feel that at CI, we can make things happen. And think about, imagine a future of what we can be at CI, especially when it comes to equity, inclusivity, and justice. And let's all strive for that marker. And know that the marker is forever evolving. And as soon as you think you're right there to reach it, then it'll kind of move away outside of your reach. But we're progressing, or moving together as a pod, and eventually we can see a better world, not just through CI, but with our students who are graduating and going out into the world and are taking all these things that we're building into their education with them. So that is what I would say.
Oh, that's cool. I like the idea of both seeing a better vision, but also seeing that the work is never done. You're not going to arrive at, you know, any perfect state, at least in this life.
Yeah.
Thanks so much for taking a little time, and all the things you're working on to share that vision with us, and look forward to seeing you at a future meeting.
Oh, you're so very welcome. Thanks for having me.